Okay, in class, in this video, we're going to cover 2.2 multiplication property of equality. So this section has 14 problems, and we're going to cover those 14 examples. So number one looked like this. And so my variable is being divided by 6. The opposite of dividing by 6 is to multiply by 6. So what I will do is I will multiply both sides by 6. Here, the multiplication of 6 and the division of 6 will cancel each other out, leaving me with my variable all by itself. But on this side, 6 times 17 is actually 102. And so my value for s is going to be 102. For number 2, it's the same thing. I'm dividing by a negative though. So in order to get rid of the division by a negative, I'm going to have to multiply by a negative 9. So the negative 9 multiplication and the negative 9 division will cancel each other out, leaving me with just the x. But negative 9 times this positive 2 gives me negative 18 on the right-hand side. Now here, the problem was 6x equal to 54. So here, I'm multiplying x by 6, which means in order to undo multiplication, I have to divide by 6 on both sides. So here the 6s will cancel, leaving me with just the x. And here 54 divided by 6 was 9. Same thing on this problem, I am multiplying r by a negative 6. So to get rid of this negative 6 multiplication, I'm going to have to divide by negative 6. So the negatives cancel and the 6s cancel, leaving me the r by itself. And then 12 divided by negative 6 is negative 2. And these expressions you can type in the calculator to get these values. Now here I'm multiplying z times 6. So to undo that, I divided by 6 on both sides. Here the 6s cancel, leaving me z. Here you could just type that in the calculator and it'll tell you it's negative 3/2. So if I did it in my head, but negative 9 divided by 6, it does simplify it for you and just tells you it's negative 3/2. So you wouldn't have to do this step if you were doing this in the calculator. I did it by hand and I reduced them both by 3 and I got the same negative 3/2. Now number 6. Number 6 is a little bit tricky because you have this fraction here. So the way I teach students is to do the same. I try to teach them one rule that applies to everything versus do this on this problem, do that on that problem, and do this over here on that problem. I really don't like that conditional mathematics. Sometimes it's unavoidable, like really, truly, you can't do it any other way. You have to do it. Like if I have this situation, I can do this. If I have that situation, I can do that. But in this particular problem with the fractions, I really want to use the general concepts and not specific concepts. So for me, anytime you have a problem and it has a fraction in it, okay, you always want to get rid of that fraction by multiplying every single term by that common denominator or a common denominator. So in here, I only had one denominator and it was 6. So I multiplied both sides by 6. Well, it's the same thing here. I have one denominator, so I'm multiplying both sides by that denominator. So over here, multiplied by the 9 and it went away, but I still have this 7 times the x. Over here, when I multiplied by 9, I ended up with this 189. Then because I'm still multiplying by 7, I want to get rid of that multiplication of 7. So I divided both sides by 7. And that got rid of the 7 here, leaving me with the x all alone. And 189 divided by 7 was 27. Okay. And so this is the way that I would prefer for you to do it. Some people might say, oh, well, 7 over 9 is being multiplied by x, so let me divide both sides by 7 over 9. That's okay too. It would have come out 21 divided by fraction 7 over 9. You still end up with the same 27 answer, okay? But I'm trying to teach you a strategy that will work for even the more long, complicated problems, okay? So same thing here, I do have a fraction. So I'm gonna take that denominator and multiply it on both sides. Over here, 5 times 12 is 60. Over here, the 5s just cancel and I have negative 6x. So to get rid of this multiplication by negative 6, I'm dividing by negative 6 on both sides. Here, the negatives and the sixes cancel, and here, 60 divided by negative 6 is negative 10. Here, it just was negative x equal to 20. So you have to remember that when you have a negative multiplied by x, there is actually a number, and it's an invisible 1. So it's actually negative 1x. And I tried to draw in that ghost 1. So I'm going to divide both sides by that negative ghost 1. So here, the negatives cancel, the invisible 1 cancels, and over here, 20 divided by negative 1 was negative 20. Now, this problem, we have 2x plus 14 equal to 30. Now, the biggest thing to think of here is you are unboxing a gift, okay? So when I'm wrapping the gift, when I'm creating this gift for a person, the first thing I'm gonna do is I'm gonna have my gift and then I'm gonna place my gift into a bag, right? So you've got this bag here. You place the gift into the bag. That's the first thing that you do. Then the second thing that you do is you take this bag and you fill it up with a bunch of tissue paper, right? And then you tell your friend, here's your gift, right? How does your friend get to the gift? One, they have to take the last thing that you did. They have to take the gift, the tissue paper out. Then they can remove the present or the gift from the bag. So they basically undo what you did in the opposite order, right? They have to do it in that order. So when it comes to these equations, remember the order of operations. The order of operations is always you multiply first and then you add. But if I'm undoing these operations, I have to do them in the opposite order in which you did them. So I need to get rid of the plus or the minus first, then I can get rid of the multiplying or dividing. Okay, so another way to think about it, and this is the more general key step, is that you want to always make sure that all your variables are on one side, and you need to make sure all of your constants, those are all the numbers that don't have letters. Make sure all of the constants are on the other side. So if I have my x's here, this is considered the other side. I need this constant to be over there with him on the other side. So this is the variable side. And when I say sides, I mean of the equal sign. So the left side obviously has the variables, which means the constants have to go to the right side. So this constant right here needs to move over to the right side. So I'm going to do the opposite, which is subtract 14 on both sides. I can combine those, giving me 16, and I have my 2x all alone. And then because it's multiplied by 2, I can divide by 2 to get rid of that, and I get x equals to 8. So we got a few more examples. So same thing here with number 10. I am definitely going to need to get this constant term over to the other side. So I added 14 on both sides. Then I could get rid of the 5 multiplier by dividing by 5 on both sides, giving me 7. Here, same thing, but notice that my variables are now on the right-hand side, which means I need to get this constant over to the quote-unquote other side, which is the left-hand side. So if it's plus 4, I'm going to minus 4 on both sides. So I get 7 equals to 3y all by itself. I do want to get rid of that 3 multiplier. So I divided by 3 on both sides and I ended up with this weird fraction equal y. That's okay, fractions can happen. Don't be afraid or think that you did something wrong. Try it and then you'll find out if it's right or if you actually did make an error. Now, same thing here. You have your variables here and your constants on the other side. So this constant needs to move over there. So I'm going to plus 9 on both sides. I get the negative x all by itself, and here I get 17. Now remember, negative x means a negative 1x. It's just this is a little invisible ghost 1. So I'm going to divide both sides by that negative 1 so that these can cancel and I can get x all by itself. And 17 divided by negative 1 is negative 17. Now here, notice that you have z's on the left and z's on the right. But your constant is on the right and there's only one. So if the constants are here, you need to make sure all your variables are on the other side. So that means I need to move over the negative 2z to this side. So I added 2z to both sides. That gave me 6z on the left and no more z's on the right. Then I'm trying to get z all by itself, so I need to get rid of this 6 multiplier. So I divided by 6 on both sides. So that got rid of the 6, and I got z by itself, and negative 12 divided by 6 happens to be negative 2. Now, finally, the last problem. Notice we have variables on both sides, and we have constants on both sides. So in this case, I always move the variables first and the constants later. So I took these 20 and made sure I moved them over to the left-hand side. I do have a choice here. I could have also moved the 6x over that way, but I like all my variables to be on the left. There's a reason for that. When we get to inequalities later, where there's like a less than or a greater than in between, it is important that your x's are on the left. So there's a reason why I always want them on the left. If I can't avoid it, that's okay. I'll show you how to fix that. But normally you want your x's on the left. So this was a positive 20x, so I minused 20x on both sides. So 6 take away 20 was actually negative 14. So since I was combining x's, I have a negative 14x. My minus 2 is still there. The 20x's are now gone, but I still have this positive 5 on the other side. Now all my variables are on the left, but that means this constant needs to go over to the right. The whole goal is to get your variables on one side and all the constants on the other side. So I'm going to have to add 2 to both sides. So I get negative 14x all by itself equal to 5 plus 2, which is 7. Then I need to get rid of this negative 14 multiplier. So I'm going to divide by negative 14 on both sides. Now, if you type this in the calculator, it will tell you that the answer is negative 1/2. You don't have to go through all of these steps, okay? This was me doing it by hand. I've noticed that 7 went into both, so I reduced it. And then you never leave a negative at the bottom. You always put it to the front. And so it should go there, okay? That's just one quick side note. This is equivalent to this, which is equivalent to this, okay? That's different from this, both of them being negative. In that case, it would just be a positive 1/2, okay? But it doesn't matter whether there's one negative on the bottom, one negative in the top, or one negative out in the front. It just makes the whole fraction negative. But if you've got 2 negatives, top and bottom, then it makes the fraction positive. Okay. And normally we don't write these are informal. If the fraction is supposed to be negative, they do like to write them with the negative in the front of the fraction. That's just a formality. But that is the end of this section, and we will be moving on to section 2.3, solving linear equations. So they do get more complicated in the next video, but I will see you in the next video.